Hi everyone, this is Sam Gansfried, and I'm going to be presenting on a fast, complete algorithm for multiplayer Nash equilibrium. So, for computing Nash equilibrium, there are multiple challenges. So for two-player zero-sum games, it can be computed in polynomial time. For example, there's a linear program formulation. For games with more than two players, and for two-player general sum games, it's PPAT hard and conjectured that there's no polynomial time algorithms. Furthermore, from a conceptual perspective, there's no performance guarantee of a Nash equilibrium in multiplayer games. So for two-player zero-sum games, there's the minimax theorem, and basically you can guarantee the value of the game and expectation. If you switch roles of player one and player two, you can guarantee breaking even and expectation. But there's no guarantee for multiplayer games. There can be different values of the equilibria. If the opponents play strategies from one equilibrium that's different from ours, then the resulting strategies may not be in equilibrium, etc. So there are a lot of challenges in general for more than two players. And so empirically, despite the fact that there's no theoretical guarantee, empirically, Nash equilibrium strategies or approximations of them have performed well in practice. So for I actually ran a class project for an AI class I taught where I had students make agents for three-player Coon Poker. Then after the class ended, I went and I looked up an exact Nash equilibrium for this game. It was a relatively small game and played that. It turns out that it defeated all of the agents from the class that used a variety of different approaches. More recently, there was an agent for six-player No Limit Texas Hold'em that defeated humans, and it attempted to approximate Nash equilibrium strategies. It didn't compute exact Nash equilibrium. It used this algorithm called counterfactual regret minimization that is a technique that is been shown to converge to equilibrium in certain games in three-player Coon Poker, but not in other games, a simplified poker game called three-player Leduc Hold'em. So in practice, Nash equilibrium can still be very effective in these games, despite the fact that there's not a theoretical worst case guarantee. So, what does it mean for an algorithm to be complete? So before I get into that, I'll mention there have been prior algorithms developed for multiplayer games, but many of them are slow. They sometimes produce solutions with poor quality, like, for example, CFR did not converge in a small poker game, and many of them are incomplete. Now, an algorithm is complete if it always finds a solution when one exists. This is generally used in AI and optimization algorithms. Now, a Nash equilibrium is known to always exist in finite games. So in this case, we know an algorithm always exists, and so an algorithm that always finds a Nash equilibrium is going to be complete. Now we can have algorithms, like I said, they can be produce something that's not in equilibrium. They could throw an error, they could run forever, they could output some empty output, and that would make them incomplete. Now there can be some nuances with these numerical algorithms, right, when you're doing numerical optimization. And so there's a convention to use a cutoff, assuming payoffs in 0-1, of epsilon, the approximation error of 0.001 has been used as a prior benchmark. I'll get more into that in the future. But the point is that, you need to allow for some degree of numerical instability sometimes in some of these algorithms. But generally, we're looking for an algorithm that is always going to find an essentially exact Nash equilibrium. You can look over this later. I'm not going to get too into it, but we're using standard notation. We're going to look at matrix games, finite set of players N, finite set of pure strategies for each player SI, utility function, real valued. We're going to assume that the SI are disjoint, and we're going to assume they all have the same cardinality. I'm not going to get too much into this, but this is going to help with the simplifying the notation of the algorithm. So we have this U hat algorithm function here. So the U is the normal utility. U hat of a vector of strategies is essentially, if the strategies are not in order of the player, we can have player one, player two, player three. Let's say I list you hat and it's of a strategy for player two, then one of player one, then one of player three, it's going to be equal to just the utility of those strategies in the order of players. So the utility function is designed to be a mapping from the cross product of strategy spaces to the real number. And so this is just essentially you had is just going to reorder the strategies so that they're in order of the players. I'll discuss this a little more later. Other than that, we're using all standard notation. Mixed strategies are probability distribution over pure strategies. Big sigma I is the set of full mixed strategies for player I. Nash equilibrium is a strategy profile where no player can gain by deviating to another strategy. Sigma sub minus I is the strategy component of the strategy vector of all the players excluding player I. And so for a candidate strategy profile, sigma star epsilon is going to be the maximum amount that any player can gain by deviating to another strategy from that profile. So I'm gonna actually, before I get into our algorithm, I'm gonna review an algorithm for computing Nash equilibrium in two-player general sum games. It's a linear mixed integer feasibility program. It was published in 2005. I'm actually gonna read, this is from their paper. And so they have a feasibility program. The feasible solutions are exactly the equilibrium of the game. For every pure strategy SI, there's a binary variable. If the variable is set to 1, the probability placed on the strategy must be 0. If it's set to 0, the strategy is allowed to be in the support, but the regret of the strategy must be 0. The formulation is the following other variables than the B binary ones. For each player, there's a variable UI, which is the highest possible expected utility the player can gain given the other player's mixed strategy. For every pure strategy SI, there's a variable PSI indicating the probability placed on the strategy, and there's a variable USI indicating the expected utility of playing that strategy given the other player's mixed strategy. There's also a variable RSI, which indicates the regret of playing SI. There's a constant UI, which is the maximum difference between two utilities in the game for player I. And so from this, we have this formulation. I'm not going to get into in too much detail, but I'll quote again from their paper. It's shown to basically be an exact formulation of Nash equilibrium. The first four constraints ensure that the PSI values constitute a valid probability distribution and define the regret of a strategy. Constraint 5 ensures that the BSI can be set to 1 only when no probability is placed on SI. On the other hand, constraint 6 ensures that the regret of a strategy equals 0 unless BSI equals 1, in which case the constraint is vacuous because the regret can never exceed UI. And technically, this constraint 3 is redundant as it follows from constraints 4 and 10. Actually, in our multiplayer algorithms, we're going to remove this vacuous constraint, redundant constraint 3 for our formulation. So this is a two-player mixed integer linear feasibility program formulation from prior work for computing Nash equilibrium. So based on that, I'm going to create a new formulation, which is for three players. And so the issue was just immediately looking to three players is now this USI here is going to be a nonlinear function of the existing variables. You have to multiply the probability that player J plays SJ and probability player K plays SK. So previously you'd have to multiply together two variables. It's no longer linear. However, we now have this new variables P, SJ, SK, which are equal to the product of PSI and PSJ. So this is going to be quadratic. So we have a new formulation, very similar to the old one. It has quadratic constraints. We can condense it a bit. So this is writing everything out. We can condense it, make it more compact if we use this U hat notation to represent all these different constraints together, but this is the same idea. So our initial three-player formulation is similar. It has mixed integer, it is linear, it has some continuous and integer variables, but it has some quadratic constraints. Now, for four players, we can do something pretty similar. Now it's actually cubic. These inspected utilities. However, despite it being cubic, we can sort of do two rounds. We can have strategies that correspond to product of one of three of them, and then product of two of them. And basically, we can reduce it. Instead of being cubic, this whole thing is still quadratic. We're just going to have more variables. So we now, for four players, we also have a quadratic mixed integer feasibility program. We can simplify it as before. We can do a similar one for five player that's, again, going to just have quadratic constraints. And in general, we have, for n players, we're going to have a formulation that has only linear and quadratic constraints. It is going to be exponential in the number of players, the size of the program, but polynomial in the number of strategies. So if we're looking for a fixed number of players, treating that as a constant, like four player or three player, then we're okay. It's still going to be polynomial size. And so it's a non-convex quadratically constrained program. And it turns out Gorobi, one of main optimization solvers, they've recently introduced a new approach that applies to non-convex programs with quadratic constraints. It uses analog of simplex algorithm with McCormick envelopes, new approaches for cutting planes. And so we're going to be using Gorobi software in our experiments. We experiment on a few different game classes. So first I'll be talking about random games where we have payoffs uniformly in 0-1. And we look at a variety of different numbers of players and numbers of strategies. We use the same parameter value. So there's a prior algorithm we're going to be comparing to, among others, that's also complete. And we're going to use the same parameter values and game classes as in those experiments. For each set of parameters for the random games, we do 1,000, except only 100 for the largest class. So we set a time limit of 900 seconds, as prior work did. We have certain parameter in Gorobi where we have 0.0001 for the feasibility tolerance. We use 8 threads, and we use very similar hardware to what was done in the prior experiments. So this shows for random games, the upper graph here shows our new algorithm, varying n is the number of players, m is the number of strategies per player. So for all of them except the largest one, the 5 player with the 3 strategies, we can see we're averaging, fraction of a second or, 1 second, and the median time is fraction of a second, and none of them are over time. Now, we do run into issues on the biggest class where the average time is 600, but we go over time 58%. So, for the biggest class, we do run into scalability issues, but for all the other ones, it runs extremely quickly. So now in the bottom, we have two other previously proposed complete algorithms. We have the exclusion method and K-uniform search. We can see that for a lot of, pretty much all of them, other than the biggest one, our runtime's a lot better. Some of theirs are, 900 seconds, 352 seconds, whereas ours is a fraction of a second. They're often running overtime on all of them, whereas ours only is in the biggest case. And basically, ours has a much lower runtime than these, except on the biggest game class. So next, there's this repository of games, this Gamut database of games, which represents a lot of different game classes. And so we generated games, 1,000 games from each class, did the same classes and parameters as prior experiments. We see here some of these games, they output games that had NaN payoffs, and so we disregarded these invalid games. We're solving all of them with our algorithm, and we're almost always a fraction of a second, 0.001, 0.005. Look at the exclusion method. On one of these classes, it was 35,000 seconds. It was 159, 880. The K-uniform search was sometimes pretty good, but sometimes got up to 80, 27, and sometimes it didn't solve it within the desired degree of accuracy. So we significantly outperform these algorithms on all of these game classes. Now, there's also a set of incomplete algorithms that are with the Gambit algorithm pack. And so we can compare to these. These are not guaranteed to always compute in equilibrium. We can see, in fact, for some of them, they have a very high percentage of not solving the instance. And interestingly, our algorithm actually outperformed all of these in terms of running time as well, even though ours has the completeness guarantee. So pretty much across the board, We're outperforming all these existing approaches. I'm briefly going to touch a little bit upon, I mentioned counterfactual regret algorithm was used in multiplayer poker. Fictitious play is another common algorithm, iterative algorithm that's been applied to multiplayer games. They may run faster than ours and be more scalable, but if the goal is to compute exact equilibrium, we can see here for varying numbers of players and actions, none of them obtained the desired level, the previous benchmark of 0.001 epsilon. You can see often at 0.05, 0.08, 0.04. And so there are games when these might be very far from equilibrium, and so these are not as good for the goal of computing exact equilibrium. The different algorithms we compared against, I'm not going to go through all of them, they're in the paper, but to conclude, we clearly outperformed all the best complete algorithms and incomplete algorithms, which frequently fail to compute a solution. The popular counterfactual regret minimization, fictitious play, are unsatisfactory for computing an exact equilibrium. We do have an issue with scalability. There's exponential number of variables and constraints in the number of players. We'd like to improve the scalability of the algorithm, which will likely involve coming up with improved algorithms for solving non-convex quadratically constrained programs. Thank you.